open the discussion onto our website so other members who can't join us this morning will be able to view it. Our format will be that each speaker will have 10 minutes. They'll speak their presentation that they have for us. And then towards the end of the cafe, we'll have about half an hour for questions and answers. What we would ask is, could you please use the chat function within Zoom to ask any question of the speakers? And it would also be helpful for us if you could just sort of mention to whom your question is directed. And that will just help us sort them out a little bit more. So without further ado, I shall hand over to Jessica. Good morning. Good to see you.
Good morning.
The floor is yours.
Okay, great. So I'm going to start just by reading the letter of support that I've written to the town to sort of give an overview of some of the thoughts I have in regards to the Three Sisters Mountain Village area structure plans. And then I'm going to elaborate on a few of the points there that I think are the most important and the most exciting aspects of the area structure plan, what it means for Canmore. So my letter to the town that I've submitted simply says, to whom it may concern, I am writing to express my support for both the Three Sisters Mountain Village area structure plans, Smith Creek and Three Sisters Village. I've been a resident of the Bow Valley for 32 years and for 22 of those years in Canmore. And I've been a business owner in Canmore in town for the entirety of those 22 years. Moving forward with development of these Three Sisters lands is necessary to provide much needed housing and affordable housing in the area. The development of these lands have been in the plans for decades, and it is judicious for the landowners in Canmore to reasonably develop their properties to their highest and best use. Landowners have worked very, or these particular landowners have worked very closely with the town of Canmore, the province of Alberta, and the residents of the area for many years in an attempt to accomplish the impossible task of satisfying all parties. The additional housing will be welcome in this community, and we are desperate for housing and for affordable housing, and we are experiencing really, I'm paraphrasing my letter now. We are experiencing really steep appreciation in real estate in Canmore right now due to the growing demand. And the demand is expected to continue to rise in the future. It's imperative to allow housing prices to try to stay in the realm of affordable by providing adequate housing opportunities. In addition to housing, I find the Village Center a really exciting project on many fronts. A visitor destination that attracts travelers from Alberta, Canada, the US, and the world would be beneficial for the economy of Canmore long after the construction industry is no longer dominant. The innovation district in the Village Center will help attract and grow new business to the area and hopefully diversify the economy to some degree, protecting our fragile economy from a single industry volatility. The indoor recreation center can be designed to be a unique sports-specific indoor training ground for amateur and elite athletes alike. Again, attracting year-round destination visitors and expanding high-end demand recreational opportunities for the residents. All new real estate developments require a lot of attention, planning, and consultation with the affected parties. New developments are permanent and there's only one chance to get it right. After decades, literally, of planning and consultation and amendments, it is time to move forward. I strongly support both the area structure plans and look forward to the thoughtful additions to the town of Canmore. That is my forever home. So that is a little bit of a paraphrased letter that I had sent to the town of Canmore. And as I said, I want to expand just a little bit on a couple of those points that I think are quite relevant. And one, this development has been in on the plans for decades. Like, this is not a new thing. This is not a new introduction. And I think it's fair that after a particular owner, and I don't it doesn't matter if it's a landowner that owns 80% of the remaining developable land or somebody who has a lot somewhere that they want to develop a home. It's fair that landowners in Canmore have the right to develop their land. And, you know, after a couple of decades, I think it's time to move forward. The addition to housing is a no-brainer. Right now, we are going through one of the busiest, one of the most in-demand times I've seen in Canmore in the last 20 some odd years. The demand for real estate in Canmore is not going to slow down. We need the inventory to supply the demand. Otherwise, the demand is going to be on the existing inventory, and prices are going to be out of many people's affordability very quickly. So not only the housing and providing inventory, but affordable inventory. So, you know, to some percentage of this will be affordable housing, and it's something that Canmore has always needed, and we will continue to do so. So this is an important aspect. The commercial is exciting. We have always wanted to have a certain amount of the tax base to come from commercial, and I know we haven't met that yet, and adding new additional commercial that can help ease the tax base on residential is beneficial, but also the fact that it sounds counterintuitive, but the more commercial we have that is attracting visitors, the more it's going to be beneficial for everyone. So it's not an addition of competition. It's actually adding new exciting businesses that will attract more people to the business that, or to the town that, if, that will benefit all business owners. We had talked about, the Village Center. I'm super excited about the Village Center. There's one thing to develop property to fulfill the existing demand that we have for both housing and for providing, destinations for visitors, but to actually create a destination for new visitors that maybe haven't had a reason or hadn't considered coming here, that's what I see the Village Center being. So it's going to fulfill the need for existing demand for our visitors to Canmore, but I see the Village Center bringing people in from outside of Alberta, outside of Canada, bringing in more US visitors. And the reason being, I see it being a destination for what it provides.
One minute left.
Yes. Oh, sorry, I'm just rambling.
Sorry to interrupt.
So, one of the things I see is this indoor recreation center being a training ground. So it's going to add fantastic benefits to our locals, which for me, I'm very personally excited about, but I see it being a urban mountain adventure sport destination. So we have youth and professionals and amateurs all coming here to a year-round destination camp. And that would include this indoor and the outdoor recreation being created in Three Sisters Mountain Village, in the Village Center. So sorry, that was a lot of information with no particular order to it, but hopefully that shared my thoughts on why I support.
Thank you very much, Jessica. And yeah, this is a conversation cafe. So conversation is the topic that we're looking for here. So without further ado, I shall hand the floor over to Rod. The floor is yours for 10 minutes.
Excellent. Thank you, Ben. I'm just going to share my screen here. Just one second. Turn my video back on. So there we are. I'm hoping everybody can see my screen. And I am going to start going right here. Yeah, so good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us. My name is Rod DeLeo. I'm a financial professional with over 30 years experience. I moved to the Bow Valley in late 1997. I originally worked for the Three Sisters Resorts as an assistant controller in 1998. I went on to hold the CFO position for the town of Canmore for 11 years And I've been instrumental in creating the town's offsite levy model, the utility rate models, and various long-term financial planning models. As of late, I have actually helped create several fiscal impact studies for both TSMV and Silvertip. I've chosen to get involved because based on my professional background and as a long-term resident, I am genuinely concerned that the development in these ASPs will be a detriment to our community. I've got 10 minutes. I saw that Ben is a stickler, so I got to get moving. I'm going to talk about three things today, risks, patterns, and trends. The inherent financial risk of a project that spans almost three decades, TSMV's long-term pattern not to build commercial development as contained in their ASPs, and the current 10-year trend of unsustainable tax increases. So to begin, financial models of this complexity generally do not do a good job beyond 5 years. The town's current budgeting process has a 3 and 5 year operating and capital budget, and years 4 and 5, I know, are rarely accurate and often redone. After creating the town's 25-year financial model, I know we quickly shelved it because the complexity was just too great and the accuracy was just not worth doing, to be honest. And this really shouldn't surprise us. The town is very complex in its business. We have things like global pandemics popping up. We declare climate emergency, changing community priorities, all can dramatically alter our financial equation. Some other inherent risks, you'll see in the ASPs, there's significant ranges in the developable units. Dwelling units from 3,500 to 6,500 units of developable units. You know, that also increases the financial uncertainty for the town dramatically. Those ASPs don't contain any performance measures or milestones with which to enforce community benefit. So it's a blank check, if you will. It's a 30-year blank check. So let's also move maybe to community infrastructure financial risk. Roads, utilities, transit, fences, structures, all of that infrastructure gets transferred to the town, and then they take on the risk, whether that's maintenance risk, replacement risk, or even operational risk. Operational risk, for instance, transit. Transit is extremely expensive to operate. The town could easily create a transit system based on proposed population figures, but in the end, wealthy second homeowners just don't ride buses, so none of the projected ridership occurs, leaving taxpayers paying for an underutilized service. We've talked a lot about natural disaster financial risk. Wildfires, steep creek flooding, undermining disasters, will all look to the town for compensation of value if properties are negatively affected by events. It seems unlikely that the town can give approval for development and then claim they shouldn't be responsible if something happens. Council claiming buyer beware seems like ignoring one's civic duty. And regardless of the legalities or the ethics of that situation, I think the town is responsible for its own infrastructure and thus exposed to financial risk. On page 22 of TSMV's fiscal impact study, I noted that the town is now responsible for $4.2 million in steep creek mitigation efforts for existing TSMV development. I'm guessing here, but I'm betting that in 2004, the fiscal impact study for the Stewart Creek ASP did not anticipate that $4.2 million. And so that's a great example of that potential financial risk. So this brings us to the second risk to fiscal sustainability, and that is the holy grail of which is the commercial tax base. TSMB's fiscal analysis states that the taxes generated, and this is a critical point, so the taxes generated from residential development do not cover the costs of services required for that development. And conversely, the commercial development generates more taxes than the services required. This is consistent with every fiscal impact analysis I've been involved with, whether it's Grand Prairie or Chestermere or the MD of Rocky View. Councils are desperate for a strong commercial tax base. And really every ASP or similar document since the mid-1990s has promised commercial development. We've all been excited about the resort center. In 1998, there's a big model in the, what is now the Yoga Lounge, you know, proposing this huge commercial development. And I think councils are swayed because of that commercial development and that it truly is the answer to rising taxes. It also makes ASPs look fiscally sustainable. And I believe this is the main reason why in 2004, council approved both the 2004 TSMV Stewart Creek Structure Plan, which included 33,000 square meters of commercial, and the 2004 Resort Center, which was 100% commercial. And now it's being reborn at approximately 20% commercial, depending on what you base those numbers on. So development promises have not equated to taxable assessment, and the town needs mechanisms with which to maintain enough control that they can dictate what is developed after the ASP is approved. The last 25 years, it has been a classic case of bait and switch. Councils are baited with commercial development, but in the end, the community just gets residential development. So I'm just going to show you a quick graph of all the development on TSMV lands from 1995 to 2020. This is from Quarry Pines all the way out to the gate on Three Sisters Parkway and Stewart Creek. I did not include Walker, McNeil, Morris, those neighborhoods south of Three Sisters Drive. That would make this look even worse. This is truly sort of modern day TSMV development. And you can see out of $1.4 billion worth of development, 1.36 or 96% was residential. Only 2.4% commercial. A tiny sliver here of PAH, because I do believe affordable housing is also very important. But unfortunately, in 25 years, not a single unit of PAH has been built on TSMV land. This PAH was developed by the town. So this split, right now, the 2020 assessment split is 85% residential, 15% commercial. The town has a goal to try and get that to 66-33%. And these actual developments that are occurring on TSMV lands are putting us further and further from this goal. So why is this important? Well, let's look at the trend of tax rates over the last 10 years. And I want to be clear here, I'm not suggesting that every dollar of increase is a result of TSMV development. We have increased visitation, we have enhanced service levels, and that all contributes. But I am suggesting that the systematic development of residential properties throughout Canmore, including TSMV, and the services that they require has put significant upward pressure on residential tax rates to cover the services. So these rates are unsustainable. We're looking at 10-year residential.
Just 1 minute rates. On the clock. Sorry.
Okay, I'm going to keep going. 10-year residential rates somewhere from 58-74%. That's 5.5% compounded annually. Commercial rates have fared way better. I thought the businesses might like this. Increases only 4-38%. Gas stations, restaurants are around the 4%. Anything to do with accommodation is higher, 38%. Utility rates for both residential and commercial have been between 90-124% increase over that time, 7.5% per annum, 9.3% per annum for franchise fees. The current trend, we're doubling residential taxes every 12 years. This graph, I hope you can see it. These are annual costs and time. I've plotted the actual increases for 10 years here, 2010 to 2020, and then projected increases with those same increases for the 10 years. You can see it's kind of looking a bit like a COVID chart. This is our CPI increase, 1.67%. And these are the various increases there that we're seeing. So in light of time, I'm gonna just skip a little bit ahead. This is why communities are so eager for commercial development. Residential development puts continued upward pressure on taxes. TSMV continued development of residential development has helped contribute to these municipal tax increases. So getting back to the impact study, yes, currently as advertised, we have a net positive impact. However, the analysis states that this is contingent on all of the commercial development being developed and the valuations of the commercial development. So that's the value of the, that particular property to make it become net positive. The historic trends
I'm very sorry to interrupt your presentation. I have let you run over a little bit there. So thank you for your contribution. I will now turn the floor over to Chris. I do apologize. There will be time later for the in the question and answers.
Ben, can I go to my last slide at least and give you a one recommendation? I mean, that's
okay. Okay, sure.
Yeah, thank you. So my recommendation to council and TSMV here is that for development to occur, it must have guaranteed benefit to our community. To do this, it must minimize the financial uncertainties, maintain future control by the council. It must contain as much commercial development as negotiable. I feel it must contain measures to ensure the commercial development is built before or at least simultaneously to residential development, and must contain clauses where residential development is only permitted as certain milestones are achieved in commercial development. We must change the pattern of the development, and council must do that for us. Thank you, Ben. Sorry to go over.
No. Thank you very much, Rob. It's very always good to have some passion in any kind of presentation. So really thank you for that as well. And I'm sorry we're under the time constraint here. Okay, thank you very much. Moving over now to our next speaker, Chris Ollenberger. Chris, you have 10 minutes. The floor's yours. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. I do tend to find myself on camera a little bit distracting, so I hope you don't mind if I just turn off the camera. I'll be happy to see you, of course, during the question period, and I'm expecting a lot of questions from the previous presentation, so that'll be fantastic. So Three Sisters has proposed two different area structure plans, the Smith Creek area structure plan, the Three Sisters Village area structure plan. Oh, where is my mouse to move the next slide? There it is. Thank you. This is an overall picture of the development. You can see Three Sisters Village on the left and Smith Creek area structure plan on the lower right. I'm giving an abbreviated version of a presentation I gave to council just out of respect for time and to maximize the amount of time for questions. But you can see the existing community of Three Sisters Creek, Stewart Creek, the Stewart Creek Golf Course in the middle, and of course the highway interchange in the center of the screen. We heard from council in 2017 that they would like to see a vision for the remaining TSMV lands concurrently as a whole. So that's why we brought forward two area structure plans. And they also asked that the wildlife corridor system be completed so that the corridors are known and we could firmly define what the developable area that's left over would be. They had some concerns about undermining, which we went hard with the province and the town of Canmore collaboratively to address guidelines in 2020, and those were updated. And they wanted to see how the ASPs aligned with the town's current municipal development plan, because there was a very long period of time in which the town, almost 20 years, went without an update to their municipal development plan. So happily, the town has updated their municipal development plan and their integrated transportation plan. Then these two area structure plans put them at the front and center as council direction. How recreation remains an important component to the resort village area structure plan. And what are the impacts to Canmore's transportation network and how development would be phased and staged? So we held a number of workshops and meetings with town administration, of course, because they have a key role to play in ensuring that the plans that were put forward meet all of their policies, including MDP alignment, and making sure that it is fiscally sustainable for them. And we can certainly talk about that. They also, of course, wanted to see affordable housing be a part of the mix. Economic diversification is, of course, important to any municipality, not just Canmore. But Canmore is probably a little bit ahead of the curve of some municipalities on integrated transportation planning. And so transportation figured highly in terms of what people would like to see within Three Sisters Mountain Village. And of course, they wanted to see how the development area that was left over after 60% of Three Sisters lands was given up for wildlife corridors would interact and have mitigations and monitoring and adaptive management measures in place. The Three Sisters Village Area Structure Plan has a permitted cap of 3,000 residential units, and above 3,000 requires a bonusing toolkit to a maximum of 5,000. And there is the range that we talked about there, but this range is critical to implementing Canmore's Climate Action Plan. This is one of the tools in which we can actually accelerate Canmore's improvements on the Climate Action Plan is through the incentivization of bonusing within the builder framework. So this would lead to a total permanent and visitor population estimate in that range of about 5,500 to 10,000 people. But it's important to remember that that's not actually a census population number. That's actually a total of visitors, tourist homes, hotel units, and residential units. And so we want to make sure that, you know, the actual permanent population is likely around 60 to 70% of the maximum total. The rest are visitors, hotel guests, and tourists. We have an indoor recreation area of about 188,000 square feet and retail and business commercial about 602,000 square feet. And you can see that actually one of the largest uses in the area is still open space at 40% of the plan area. Interestingly, actually, the amount of taxable land on a commercial basis in this area structure plan is not 20%. It's actually 64% if you carefully look at the map and actually look at all the uses that are participating within it. But better yet, if you actually did a gross floor area analysis, which anyone can do by reading the area structure plans, they would find it's actually 75% commercial by gross floor area within this area structure plan. Considering some of the questions that council had, of course, they absolutely do have some of the recommendations you saw on the screen earlier, and that the phasing and sequencing that are shown on the screen here consider the transportation impact assessment, the environmental impact assessment, extension of municipal infrastructure, planning parameters and phasing, and such that the commercial is brought on before you can bring on the last phase of residential and complete some portions. So there is the belts and suspenders aspect to make sure that the phasing was sequenced carefully and properly. One of the last things you don't want to do is pretend to build a commercial island in the middle of nowhere if there's no customers around it, so to speak. And some of those customers, because of the way we frame this area structure plan, need to be close by. So phase one starts with some residential to bring some nearby customers and also tourist home space. And then phases 2A also have commercial components. Phase three is the village core and primarily commercial in nature. Phase 2B is completely commercial in nature. Phase four is about half commercial in nature. And then last, phase five is the residential portion. And that isn't brought on until the commercial centers are complete. And that's right in policy in the area structure plan. The neighborhood framework for Smith Creek is a little bit different because the town wanted to be cognizant of a future potential school site that's located in the center of it. They wanted to make sure that they had basically a local orientated population to support walking to school and kids going to school using the park space and things like that. But in addition to that, one of the things that they really asked for was an expansion of a business park type of environment, which you can see there in the Thunderstone Quarry part of the lands. They were looking to see that they could get enhanced warehouse, logistics, light manufacturing spaces, because currently there really is none left within the town of Canmore. Those type of uses require a connection to the Trans-Canada Highway and proximity to the interchange. So that's why they're close to Dead Man's Flats and also make use of what will be a mined out area at the end of the day by the time Thunderstone is completed. We can accelerate bringing that on if need be. Just a matter of time on which phasing makes the most sense to council in a lot of ways. The Smith Creek phasing is talking about using the efficient extension of municipal infrastructure again, planning parameters. And you see phase one there, but what is probably should be labeled phase one is a new wildlife underpass underneath the Trans-Canada Highway. The Trans-Canada Highway underpass would be built first, where the arrow crossing on the most easternmost arrow on the Trans-Canada Highway. The current wildlife underpass would stay, and that allows for the animals to get used to the new underpass, and then phase one can be built. We have a lot of wildlife mitigations, of course, and there's over 100 of them. It's definitely not just focused on fencing. There's a lot of mitigations that are in place. But the fencing, we believe, is crucial to reducing negative human-wildlife interactions. Unfortunately, we can set all the land aside that we have, and the corridors may still not work if we cannot control random human and pet use within the corridors, as we found within the Human Use Management Report that was jointly authored by several governments. 94% of the use in the corridors was humans and their pets in the corridors. That was the largest problem going to actually making the wildlife corridors work. So providing some fencing really to delineate wildlife safe space and development safe space for humans to use and their families to enjoy is part of the wildlife fencing program. And there also be gates that'll control access to the corner. So the gates are intended such that you can get to the Highline Trail, you could go up Three Sisters Creek, for example, but it would bring an end to the proliferation of random so-called pirate trails that are scattered throughout the entire wildlife system today. Education becomes an easier component once you've got designated control and access point. And another key component is, as I mentioned, over 40% of the resort village area is still recreational, but to provide outdoor recreation opportunities within the development footprint so that humans are not enticed to go out into the corridor to recreate. So we have a number of benefits, and I'm skipping along pretty quickly through those benefits, to be honest, but we do have 20% affordable housing. And it's not just one type of affordable housing. This is a massive improvement from the old area structure plans, but it's actually a spectrum of housing choices that would provide for the ability for both renters and homeownership options and a spectrum of housing choices, where some of the previous ASPs really focused on, say, entry-level homes, which was mainly a restriction in size and an attempt to bring down price. But we believe, and we've got a good bonusing toolkit model and a housing.
Sorry to let you know you've got a minute left there. Apologies for interrupting.
I'm sure there'll be a couple of minutes, but it was from Rod. But thank you. I will speed it up. And you can see a number of the other benefits on the screen here, just being cognizant of time. Ta-da. I should have warned you, Ben, that was the last slide. I was just playing with you a little bit.
No, not a problem at all, Chris. Thank you very much. Appreciate your presentation there. Over to our final speaker, Sarah. Good morning. Nice to see you. Your presentation slot is yours for the next 10 minutes.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for having me. Can you guys all hear me okay?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, perfect. So I don't have slides to share, but I have a few points I wanted to just share with you all. So first of all, I'll just introduce myself. Some of you already know me, but a lot of you don't. My name is Sarah Elmaligi, and I have been working as a landscape ecologist and conservation planner in the Bow Valley for 15 years since I moved there, or almost 15, I guess, if I'm being completely honest. My PhD and my research specialty has really focused on how grizzly bears and recreationists share the landscape in the national parks, the provincial parks, and also on public lands, specifically in the Bow Valley, but I have worked with grizzly bears and recreationists across Western Canada. I'm here today representing the Canadian Parks and Wilderness Society, who I have worked with as a contractor. I'm working on the National Park and Bow Valley related conservation issues. And my job is to provide recommendations for improving ecological integrity in a already highly impacted landscape. Our position is that the two bylaws associated with TSMV and Smith Creek be rejected by Town Council. As a biologist, I have grave concerns about the impacts associated with these ASPs for several reasons, and I'll kind of provide the high level concerns here, and then I'm available to answer questions, obviously. Overall, I think there's an unacceptable level of risk associated with the multiple aspects of the developments as proposed. We really need to be cognizant of the fact that these are not undisturbed lands. The Bow Valley is already a highly impacted land base where carnivore and ungulate species from grizzly bears to elk and everything in between are already challenged to succeed and live long lives. These developments will compound existing development and human use patterns in negative ways, making it even harder for our native species to proliferate and be happy. While the impacts may not seem significant as suggested by the environmental impact statement, they do present an unacceptable level of risk due to the high level of uncertainty regarding outcomes. Overall, but this the next few comments apply to both ASPs. A lot of these are also discussed in the third-party review of the environmental impact statements. The environmental impact statements used outdated data to conduct models that were inappropriate to assess wildlife movement. The EIS uses models that are actually used to assess habitat quality, and that's not quite the same thing. Scientifically, that's not the same thing as the data that feeds into wildlife movement. So it's not appropriate to use a model for habitat quality and infer that to movement patterns. Basing an EIS on modeling is fine, but the models are subject to error based on the data that inputs into them. And thus the recommendations coming out of that model are a little bit inappropriate and old. I don't think that the models in the EIS can be trusted. Newer data shows, and I mean, it's so new, I just read it last night. It's like literally just been released, shows the high level of reliance of wolves, bears, and cougars on the entire Through Valley corridor for movement. Given the length of this corridor, it also serves an important habitat function. When corridors are this large and animals spend this much time in them, habitat quality is important, but it's not quite of the whole picture. The development will remove habitat as well as impact movement. I'm very certain of that. The longer carnivores spend in the space, the higher the risk of human-wildlife conflict. And we see this every day in the summer with existing developments and existing human use patterns in and around the corridor, especially in berry season. The mitigations proposed in the environmental impact statements are not guaranteed to work. Mitigations never are, but the development assumes that they will. This high level of uncertainty with mitigation effectiveness is really concerning for me, especially considering that many of the mitigation measures, other than the fence around the whole neighborhood, but many of the other mitigation measures like education and communication, those are already being applied in the areas around the peaks of Grassy and the other neighborhoods adjacent to the existing corridor. Those are already being applied and they're not leading to reduced human use in the corridor or reduced human wildlife conflict. In fact, human wildlife conflict is increasing each year. No fence works 100%, no fence ever has. Anybody who has ever worked with a cattle rancher or with Banff National Park knows that a long fence line is costly and requires ongoing maintenance and continual checking. Staff capacity is required to ensure the successfulness of a fence. Banff National Park actually employs people to check on the fence on a daily basis and to address any wildlife incursions on the fence. So I think it's a little bit problematic that the ASPs suggest that the fence will solve the problem when it really is not a guarantee. The mitigations around the fence are also not adaptive because there's no allowance for moving or removing the fence or houses once they've been built. So you can build a fence and monitor its effectiveness, but there's no allowance in the environmental impact statement that if it proves not to be effective, that we'll move the fence or we'll take it down or we'll do something else. And that is the essence of adaptive management. At the minimum, development should be phased and linked to demonstrated success of mitigation measures. There should not be perimeter trails around either development. Recreation inside the community will not replace recreation in the wildlife corridor. And I think it's a little bit of a misnomer to suggest that a pathway system inside a community will replace recreational opportunities in a wildlife corridor. If that is the case, I'd love to see some social science that demonstrates that. There will be several thousand more people in the area, and they won't all be recreating inside the community. In terms of Smith Creek, I do find the Smith Creek development particularly problematic because it represents the largest increase in human activity. There is not actually a lot happening in that Smith Creek area right now, and so we're going to go from very little human activity to a lot of human activity. The area contains no designated trails currently, and the ASP will result in a dramatic increase in human use. This is concerning because just behind Smith Creek is an area called the Wind Valley Habitat Patch, which is critical habitat, really came out as being super important for multiple species in the Banff Bow Valley study. efforts have been taken to protect the Wind Valley from development, and putting a massive neighborhood at the mouth of the Wind Valley can have really huge implications for wildlife. Development in Smith Creek will compromise wildlife movement from the Wind Valley to Banff National Park. Current science shows that putting a development here will hinder wildlife movement and may even render this corridor ineffective. That actually has international connectivity implications. The impacts of the development will spill beyond the footprint as people begin to recreate in a corridor in large numbers where they currently are not recreating. Changes to the urban growth boundary to accommodate development are wholly inappropriate. There's no point in us drawing boundaries around stuff if we're just able to amend them when we start to feel like those boundaries don't work for us anymore. The proposed development in the quarry area is right at the mouth of the Wind Valley. So not only is the proponent suggesting that the town change its urban growth boundary, it's suggesting to put a neighborhood in close proximity to sensitive and critical wildlife habitat at the mouth of a critical wildlife corridor. There is no way to mitigate these impacts and make this acceptable for wildlife. There are no designated trails in this area of the Along Valley corridor, and Alberta Parks has not committed to building a highline extension this far, like as far as Pigeon Creek and Dead Man's Flats. And if Alberta Parks did decide to build that, CPAWS would fervently oppose designated recreation trails in this area. There should not be a designated trail network running the entire length of the Along Valley corridor. That, in combination with a neighborhood, is likely to sever the corridor. The underpass.
Sorry, just let you know. You've got a minute left. Apologies for the interruption.
No worries. I'm almost done. The underpass realignment is also really problematic because it takes time for animals to learn to use the landscape differently. So I don't really think that the EIS fully addresses the learning process and the length of time it will take for that. In terms of the Three Sisters Mountain Village development, developing right up to the boundary of TSMV goes against previous intentions to buffer the wildlife corridor by not allowing development on the golf course. Again, the perimeter trail and recreational activity within 100 meters of the fence is problematic, and there's just no way a community of this size will support and sustain recreational opportunities for thousands of people without those people also recreating in the wildlife corridor. So even if those people stick to designated trails, the volume of human use in the corridor stands to increase dramatically, and this will have a negative impact on wildlife movement and habitat use. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sarah.
Right in under the wire, just like Chris.
No, excellent. Thank you very much indeed. And thank you each one of our presenters there for their very informative and passionate presentations. Well, we'll now move over to question and answer session. We wanted to allow a good period of time. We had a feeling there might be the odd question or two on this topic. We have got a few that have been submitted through the chat function whilst the presentations have been occurring. So I will read those in the order they've come in and to whom they are addressed as well. After that, I will also unmute the participants for a while. So if people would like to, I was going to say in person, but virtually in person, if you understand what I mean by that, through the microphone. Okay. So the first question that we have here is addressed to all of the panel. And the question is, the term affordable housing is thrown around as a buzzword quite often, yet the context differs depending on who is talking about it. I'm wondering why the proposed development is not addressing the missing middle in Canmore, which would be defined as housing that is attainable and appropriate for local families, such as employed as the working class, teachers, park employees, priced under 600,000, 3 to 4 bedrooms, 2 living spaces in a garage. Why are there no large family orientated townhouses complexes in the plans? That is to the whole panel.
Well, I guess they're letting me go first. Is that the idea? That's okay.
Possibly, Chris, yeah.
Silence. Hopefully I can just bring something up super quickly because I believe the answer is actually we are. So hang on 2 seconds, if you could bear with me.
Of course.
So, I did pick out a slide that I presented to council during first reading, And definitely part of the housing spectrum that we're looking at was an important component of the entire Three Sisters Area Structure planning process. As I mentioned during our initial proposal, during the initial presentation, some of the 2004 area structure plan things focused on some good goals at the time, but I think relatively limited, and some of them haven't worked as much as we have. So we've incorporated those learnings and with the town of Canmore come across how we can incorporate affordable housing into a spectrum of units. And so that does actually directly correlate to what is known as the missing middle forms of housing. So we're looking at townhouses, stacked townhouses, low-rise apartments, and things like that. So those forms that can be cheaper for people to get into. I didn't get a chance to mention it just because of time limits on the presentation part, but the Three Sisters Village Area Structure Plan actually has no single-family houses within it. The single-family house form is actually limited to Smith Creek only. And that's one of the specific ways is we're looking to make sure that there is enough of those missing middle forms of housing for affordable housing components. And just to make sure other people can answer, I'll stop there.
Okay. Thank you, Chris, for those comments. Anyone else from the panel? No? Okay. Well, I'll move on to the next question. We do have a good number coming in here. So thank you, everyone, for engaging in the debate. Chris, this one is for you. Why are locals being shoved into the corner next to the quarry in one of the last phases of Smith Creek when locals are more inclined to live walkable, rideable lifestyles and need access to existing schools now, unlike second homeowners and visitors who seem to be slotted for the prime location of the two ASPs and timing priorities? So I think the inference there is the positioning of where the locals would be, next to the quarry in the phase of Smith Creek.
No, that's a great question. I'm glad that asked, because that's certainly not the case. In fact, there is specific policies within the area structure plan for the village intending to bring full-time residents into that village atmosphere as well. It is not just an enclave of visitors only. That's certainly not the case. In fact, it wouldn't be as vibrant as we want it to be if it didn't have permanent residents on and part-time residents too as part of the mix that's living within the village. So the two area structure plans are different in character for sure. One is more welcoming of visitors is probably the better way of putting it, but both area structure plans absolutely do encourage, rely on, and welcome local residents in both areas as permanent and part-time residents. So it definitely isn't an enclave of visitor here in the resort village and locals only in the Smith Creek area. The Smith Creek area was just seen as an area that would provide a different product type and a different lifestyle for people that might not want to live within the hustle and bustle of the village and might want to be closer to an additional school. Certainly they could still use the existing school that is in Stewart Creek because Rome Transit is going to go through Smith Creek should it be approved, and it also goes through Three Sisters Village should it be approved. So there'll be a connection of a variety of options there. It's welcome for everybody. It's certainly not visitors and hotel guests only.
Okay, thank you, Chris. The next question is for you again, which is, how has the current economic and environmental climate crisis that are infecting the entire globe, has that affected the development plan? Have there been any changes within the year we've just seen and the predicted economic downturn that is yet to fully unfold?
Thank you for the question. Yeah, and this is a question that actually was asked at first reading as well by council. And at the time we had the author of our municipal fiscal impact assessment and our commercial needs assessment and our socioeconomic impact assessment, all of which, of course, are very well aware of the pandemic. You can't just say that doesn't exist, but they do not believe it has actually a long-term implication that would say we should stop everything, change the plans completely, or worse even, perhaps just say we should do nothing. I think they believe that the words that they worked with within the area structure plans was to ensure that they were aligned with the municipal development plan and the integrated transportation plan, both of which are also long-term documents aligned with climate, walking, biking, transit use, things like that. And we believe that if anything, the pandemic and some of the changes that you're seeing in work from home environments would increase the demand for local services within a walking distance, such as you would find within the village or at the east end of Smith Creek.
Thank you very much, Chris. The next question is for Sarah. What is the worst case scenario impact you see for grizzlies and wolves within the development?
Within the development, I mean, the worst case scenario.
With the development. So I think how the development.
Sure.
Them, yeah.
I mean, the worst case scenario is that we don't have grizzly bears and wolves in the Bow Valley anymore. And without that corridor functioning effectively, we actually have pretty grave implications for wildlife movement beyond the Bow Valley. So the Bow Valley is actually a critical connecting corridor for grizzly bears and wolves on a much larger landscape scale, from like Alberta to BC and Montana to Alberta and continuing north through Alberta. So if that corridor is suddenly not functioning and wildlife are not moving through it, we could lose those carnivore species from the Bow Valley. Like, that's the worst case scenario.
Okay, thank you very much. The next question is, Rod, for you, which is that you've stated the realty taxes do not cover the costs for new services. Are the new services not addressed by the offset levy programs, given that you're referencing maintenance? How are you modeling maintenance costs for the brand new infrastructure?
Yeah, so the offsite levy program actually covers infrastructure costs basically from the property line. So the infrastructure on the property itself is Three Sisters is responsible for that. Offsite levy will cover the cost from the property line, say, to the wastewater treatment plant. So that really doesn't have really much impact on new services. The new services I'm really referring to are those that support that residential development. So that is everything from recreation to maintenance of roads, to bylaw, to RCMP, you know, all those services that the town provides. And so really, I think, basically in the fiscal impact study that TSMB's done, they are accounting for maintenance costs on a per capita basis. Usually, if you read the fiscal impact study, they tell you exactly how they've done it. So I think, I'm not modeling those. I think Three Sisters TSMB has modeled those, but I'm talking about basically on the principle that the residential development might generate $1,000 in taxes, but actually cost $1,400 in services. So that puts pressure on our mill rates, and you can see the resulting increases. So residential development doesn't pay in general for the services that are required for that residential. And that's stated both in the fiscal impact study and professionally everything I've ever developed, for councils throughout Alberta. They're looking for commercial development because it generates more income through taxes than the services required for it. And that's the critical point. And what we've seen over 25 years has been 96% residential, and that's what's putting pressure on our municipal taxes.
Actually, that's not quite correct. Some of the aspects within the property tax spectrum, and I'm sure you would agree, Rod, it's not just a split between residential versus commercial, but it's actually the type of development. And so when you talk about other cities have found that residential tax rates don't support the services they require, that's actually more of a topology-based question within residential as well. Say if it was a land sea of single-family houses versus a denser core like what we're providing in the village center, those are two very different equations within the residential tax structure. Absolutely, I would agree with you that if we were proposing a sea of single family houses from one end to the other, the municipal fiscal impact assessment would look quite different. But on a precautionary note, the town of Canmore also asked that the municipal fiscal impact assessment provide a base case scenario that says, what if some of these things don't happen? What is our worst case scenario? And actually it was still shown that Three Sisters Mountain Village does pay for itself within that municipal fiscal impact assessment. So it's you're partially correct in that residential doesn't always pay for itself, but it's also, you have to recognize that that's mainly a topology type of question, which is why when you see other cities and municipalities looking to densify within their urban core, that's one of the big reasons, because they can't just build commercial. The solution is not to say, let's build 100% commercial, problem solved. The actual structure is much more complicated than that.
Yeah, and I would agree, but I think if you look at maybe Frank's development, you know, there's a development that maybe you would have that argument. Unfortunately, Chris, you're looking at developing residential, I think 10 kilometers was the distance. So, you know, again, we could argue all day, I'm sure, but, you know, I do feel that it's solid information. It's basic, like really, really well thought out, you know, practice throughout Alberta, and your distance, your geographic distance, although the village center might help you out, the geographic distance from your current development out to the end of Dead Man's, you know, just, you know, that isn't a compact development in any way. So I think that would mitigate potentially your point of densification. So.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up, because of course we have the business and commercial and industrial end at the end of Smith Creek, which is actually, again, just as you described, we need more commercial tax base at the very end of Smith Creek is exactly that, a fairly large component of business industrial park, light manufacturing, commercial uses, retail uses, and some of the local services. So it's not just residential all the way out to Dead Man's Flats, 10 kilometers, and that doesn't pay for itself. That was actually thought through carefully in the mix and with the input of the town of Canmore as well.
I just want to quickly respond to that, Chris, if that's okay. So in order to do what you just proposed, you have to develop, or you're proposing to develop, the Thunderstone Quarry. And those lands specifically have a conservation related objective associated with them. Once the life of the quarry is completed, those lands are supposed to be reclaimed to resume ecological functionality and be part of the Wind Valley Wildlife Corridor. So while on the one hand you're providing this increased development for industrial purposes, which as a resident, I do value that. I think that that's great if we can have more warehouses and manufacturing spaces. We have a lot of very creative people in the Valley building and creating great things that I, as a consumer, want to buy. but the location of those requires you changing the urban growth boundary, or proposing to change the urban growth boundary, and developing an area that has specifically been set aside for conservation objectives. So you have created a situation that we can't support because you're taking the Thunderstone Quarry and turning it into something it wasn't intended for.
Oh, well, thank you for clarifying that, Sarah. I should add, though, that there is no conservation easement on top of Thunderstone Quarry. And just because the letters WC exist within the land use of this area, that specifically is addressed as well within the municipal development plan. There's a map that says this future area, which by the way does include Thunderstone Quarry, will be mapped out by an area structure plan process. So I recognize that the urban growth boundary is another step within the municipal development plan that needs to be accomplished, but there is actually no commitment within the permits from the province and things like that on Thunderstone Quarry to return that to an ecological state. It's basically just meets the best code of practice for quarrying and gravel pits and things like that, i.e. put grass back, all done. So it might be a bit of a misnomer to say that there is a condition or a requirement to return that to a corridor status, because that actually doesn't exist.
Maybe not a corridor status, but it definitely has a condition associated with it to reclaim the quarry and return it to, there are ecological restrictions on what that reclamation should look like after the quarry is closed. So whether or not a conservation easement is a legal designation for land, and that does not apply to the Thunderstone Quarry, but the understanding of town council and the residents of Canmore is that the Thunderstone Quarry, once it's finished, will be reclaimed and returned to some kind of natural space. And for you to say that just because it's not a conservation easement, we can go ahead and build an industrial area with warehouses on it, you have to be able to see how those are two completely different outcomes for this chunk of land.
Absolutely, and that's why the NRCB carefully weighed all of those objectives way back in the day and said that with the balance of wildlife corridors and other mitigations, that development is appropriate in the area. I think it's important to make sure that people know it's not a question of if development should occur? Because that's a misnomer. That question has been answered. It's really actually how development will occur. And those are two very different questions, right? And so we need to make sure that people have the framework and the acknowledgement to know that the energy and expenditure that maybe some of them are interested in doing, and is there a way we don't do Smith Creek? Is there a way we don't do any development out here? You know, that question was addressed in 1992, right? What we're really talking about now is how do we develop within the spaces left over once a wildlife corridor system has been designated?
Thank you, Chris. I'm just going to come back to the questions here. That's wonderful debate. Thank you to our panelists. And I didn't want to stop that because it was going in some great directions. So thank you. Back to the questions we've received here. Sarah, this one is for you. Your position questions the veracity of the Golden Environmental Impact Statements, EIS. Can you provide the public with the data that you're referencing as a counter EIS to support your statements?
Yes, I can. Although it's not necessarily mine to share. So there is a paper that is literally just being submitted for peer review that has been written by several local biologists, Jesse Whittington, John Peschkowski, who you may know, and a couple others, where they've actually done a cumulative effects assessment model of development in the Bow Valley and how developments, including Three Sisters, but I believe they also included the Silvertip and recreational access changes over time, how that could impact corridor functionality in the Bow Valley. And that paper has just been completed, and it contains data and GPS locations for grizzly bears and wolves and compares corridor functionality for grizzly bears and wolves through the Bow Valley. And so that is now public information. I do believe that the authors are going to share that as part of the input into the council public hearing. So unfortunately, at this time, I can't tell you where to get it, but it will be available as part of the public materials for town council.
Okay, thank you very much, Sarah. The next question, we are staying with yourself. Do you know how wildfire mitigation on the TSMV development plan will impact the wildlife corridors?
Well, I mean, wildfire mitigation typically involves removing large swaths of trees to fire smart neighborhoods and make sure that a fire is not going to come right up to the boundary of a neighborhood. And in this case, that would involve removing large swaths of trees in the wildlife corridor, which will create abundant bear habitat within, takes about 10 years after a wildfire for Schipperdia to grow back and become really productive and attracting for bears. So it could potentially compound human wildlife conflict, just because you would then have really great bear habitat right next to the wildlife fence, right next to the neighborhood, right next to where people are recreating. So wildfire mitigation actually creates good bear habitat, but the other thing that it does is reduces cover for other animals who want more cover as they're traveling through the landscape. So it might attract bears, but it might also be a deterrent for other species that actually rely on a forest to shield them from human developments. All that's pretty, it gets very hard to predict, but that's sort of what the science would suggest would be the impact.
Okay, thank you very much, Sarah. The next question is for Chris. Can you elaborate on how the wildlife corridors will be protected? Is it a conservancy?
So thank you for the question. We have used conservation easements in the past, and they're still available as a tool as well today. But one of the changes was made to, I think it's called the Land Stewardship Act. And the Land Stewardship Act made some changes since we did those previous conservation easements. And it actually permits the possibility for such conservation easements to be canceled now just by the stroke of a pen of a particular minister. So what we've decided to do is actually exchange lands with the province of Alberta. So it is proposed that the wildlife corridor lands, the lands within the corridor, would become crown lands. Now this does a couple of things. One is it takes those lands out of private ownership, obviously. But the second thing it really does, which is a request to the town of Canmore, is it clarifies enforcement, right? One of the challenges they've got with the 94% human use existing within the current wildlife corridor system out there. And anyone that's hiked the Middle Sister Trail knows that that's in the Smith Creek area. So there's definitely lots of well-known documented trails out there. They want the ability to provide for enforcement within the province as well. So if it becomes Crown land, it becomes very clear who is enforcing inappropriate use or activity within the corridors. Right now, we've got a mishmash of landowners. There's even private landowners further south than Three Sisters that have private lands up there, surprisingly enough. But this would put it in Crown, and then it would all be Crown, run by the province, managed by the province, and enforced by the province. That was one of the things that the town of Canmore was looking for.
That in itself can be problematic, though, because Alberta Environment and Parks as a ministry is typically quite underfunded provincially. And so the province doesn't have unlimited capacity to enforce human use restrictions and regulations in wildlife corridors. And that is already a problem in the South Canmore Wildlife Corridor. So we're already seeing a proliferation of pirate trails, as Chris had mentioned earlier, but also really high levels of human use, not only on the designated trail system that already exists. And enforcing regulations in the wildlife corridor, like dogs off leash or sticking to designated trails, is already a massive problem for Alberta Parks, simply because they don't have the staff and the capacity to enforce and manage that appropriately. So even though you're absolutely correct, Chris, the responsibility will fall to the province to manage the wildlife corridor, and that is as it should be. I think that that's good. But all I'm trying to say is that people should not assume that the province has the capacity to effectively manage that, because frankly, they don't. They just don't have the staff to enforce those regulations.
Yeah, I can't disagree with that currently, because they don't own the land currently either. So it's a bit of chicken and egg, but I don't disagree with you on that, Sarah.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thank you both. The next question is for Chris. Chris, why should we trust TSMV? TSMV has had 5 years to conduct consultation, and a recent poll shows under 3% of support for the current ASPs. It appears that there was very little consideration of the current residents' concerns and a sole focus on profits.
Well, I'm not sure where the question was in there, actually, to be honest, and I haven't seen
people,
so I can't speak to that.
Sorry, Chris. I think if I take away the narrative that was there with the question, I just wanted to relay that from one of our members asking. So why should we trust TSMV?
Yeah, well, it's an interesting conundrum at times, right? You know, a lot of people have said, look at what you've done in the past, when in reality, this ownership group has actually only owned the land since 2013, post the financial crisis out of the U.S. And so that's currently actually their real track record, is post 2013. And they've spent that entire time working on area structure plans, working on plans, working on EISs, working on municipal fiscal and tax assessments. And absolutely, if you go and check out the What We Heard report that's located either on the canmore.ca website or tsmv.ca website, you'll see in there pages and pages, dozens of pages of unfiltered comments that were considered as part of the program. Now, as we discussed a little bit earlier, we can't take every piece of input and say, and this is exactly how we addressed it, right? For example, there was a number of pieces of input that said, we just don't want any more development. But that wasn't the question on the table, right? The question on the table is, development has been approved by the NRCB. It's just really density, schedule, timing, and things like that that can be changed with the concurrence of the town of Canmore. And we're using the municipal development plan and the integrated transportation plan as the guidepost past that. The NRCB has decided development will occur. That question has been answered. And so therefore we couldn't use some of that input, but we did take scads and scads and scads of input about what people were wanting to see and how they wanted to see things addressed. They also wanted to see third party reviews of certain things, such as the environmental impact statement. The town definitely heard them there. So I believe the best place to look to see what we've incorporated and how we incorporate it is the What We Heard report. It's quite lengthy, so I wouldn't be able to regurgitate it here for you today.
Okay, thank you, Chris. The next question is for yourself again, which is that in October of 2020, Canmore signed a state of climate emergency. A very powerful statement, minimize our impact on climate change and reduce our carbon footprint. In an effort to build green communities that meets these objectives, how will TSMV's development address this objective? And also, could you speak to the use of renewable building materials, solar energy, green transportation, grey water, green, any green initiatives that you've had and you've used in the development?
Okay, great. Yeah, thank you for the question. So number one in the climate action plan in terms of emissions from the town of Canmore is transportation. That's number one source of greenhouse gas emissions. So embedded in the very fabric of both area structure plans is changing how transportation occurs within the town of Canmore. Right now, everybody, there's a bus loop, obviously high use of pathways and bike networks and things like that, but they want to be able to use a more focused pedestrian oriented, bicycle transit oriented approach to daily needs and daily walking about and daily going grocery shopping and stuff like that. So Three Sisters would actually be a generation beyond what you see in Spring Creek today. And there's a very good example of the type of streetscapes that can occur in Spring Creek. I think Frank Koenig has done a good job of an early iteration of that kind of network. And we're using the same tools and learnings with Andy Asarte and others within the town of Canmore to really create those pathway networks, bicycle commuting networks, connections to downtown Canmore, and all those good things like that. So that's 40% baked right into the area structure plans. It's so key. And it was an important feature of council's decision to do an integrated transportation plan. Second on the list is existing buildings. I can't help you there. People have got houses and they're going to do what they're going to do there. But number three was future buildings. And then the future buildings, we created an innovative bonusing toolkit. The town of Canmore administration has acknowledged and told council at the first reading, it's best in class. It's leading technology in terms of what people are wanting to see on it. And one of the challenges we have is that with current energy prices, people aren't seeing the return on investment, so to speak. There are people that absolutely put green technologies into their homes because it's a passion for them. But a lot of people, when they're looking at their mortgage, may not make that same equation. So what we're doing with the bonusing toolkit is allowing the ability for future builders to gain additional units still within that range I described earlier, such that they can incorporate the green technologies, alternative energy systems, geothermal if they like, solar if they like. But really the end goal is to chase towards implementation of net zero and net zero ready well in advance of when it's going to come in 2030 under the federal program anyway. One of the challenges that I'm not sure everybody knows is the town of Canmore, no municipality actually in Alberta, has the authority to modify the building code. They can't say, we want you to build net zero. In fact, we're going to require you to build net zero. No municipality in Alberta has that authority. And so what we did with the bonusing toolkit was create a system in which the town of Canmore, the development permit stage, has the ability to hold some goodies and say, you know, so builder, you're going to come along and do a better job and do net zero ahead of when everybody else in the country is going to do. And we carefully fine tuned it to ensure that the answer to that question would be yes. So I'm really excited. And I think the bonusing toolkit, if people give it a read, and actually we even modified it further after we got some public feedback in November and December, is really positive. It's a really strong attribute. And it's the only ASPs proposed in Canmore that includes such a toolkit.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Chris. The next one is Canmore in general and Three Sisters in particular are rated as extreme wildfire risks. Fort McMurray was a prime example of what can happen. Why should we take on yet another significant risk? Probably directed at you, I would think, Chris. There isn't somebody on there, but so looking at the risk again with regards to fire mitigation, which I know that we've touched upon.
Yeah, thank you. And I'm definitely not a wildfire expert by any stretch of the imagination. But I think what's important is we have provided a wildfire mitigation strategy appropriate to an area structure plan level at this stage. But that's not where it ends. And as Sarah correctly talked about, you know, sometimes there's some there's some tugs and some tensions between what is good for wildlife has now come, what is good for fire protection has now come. And so I know the local experts that we've retained and have been doing fire mitigation in the Bow Valley and Bragg Creek and many other areas throughout Alberta, a recognized expert, works closely with forestry experts and biologists to incorporate appropriate fire mitigation strategies that are still wildlife friendly. Is it going to be perfect for either way? Is it going to be a perfect barren barrier of rock, can't burn? No, because that really wouldn't work and support the wildlife corridor system that we got in place today. But will it have appropriate strategies on a layered system, which is what the Fire Smart guidelines talk about? And I think what's also important is the Fire Smart guidelines do not guarantee that there will never be a fire or that fire will never impact development. They're really meant to just basically slow down catastrophic events if they occur and buy time for firefighters to set up temporary fire breaks, brigades, get in place, all that good stuff like that. They are not intended at all to mitigate wildfire. So Canmore's actually got a very long and positive policy history with wildfire. In fact, I think they're the only municipality I know in Alberta that incorporates wildfire considerations right within their land use bylaw. Whereas, say, Rocky View County, even though they're exposed to a lot of wildfire risk, doesn't yet. So Canmore is leading edge that way. It's a staged process, and you can find the wildfire mitigation strategy on canmore.ca or tsmv.ca.
Okay, thank you very much, Chris. Next question is for you, Rod. If, say, 50% of the visitors are non-resident and only using the services 50% of the time, are the support services then underutilized and accordingly less cost to the residents?
Yeah, unfortunately, that's not generally how it works. What happens is you have to size your service for when everybody shows up. So whether that's the traffic lights to control all that crowd, whether it's the wastewater treatment plant, when everybody shows up in town and flushes at the same time, you know, the town needs to provide services that meet the need of all those individuals when they show up. And that's obviously not all the case. You know, there might be some services that would fit that bill, but generally speaking, you know, the town needs to provide services to meet all the needs or the max needs of the community. So we've seen that in wastewater treatment plants, in bylaw, roads, all of those services need to be designed so that they can handle, you know, sort of the weekend effect, if you will, or the long weekend effect. So definitely some of those services, but the majority you have to size for the long weekend.
Okay, thank you very much, Rod. And that also actually flows into the next question, which is for you, Chris, which is, how is everyone from TSMV and Stewart Creek going to get downtown on a weekend over the one existing downtown bridge?
Well, hopefully they're not getting in their car, because that is definitely not the intent of the town of Canmore. The town of Canmore, it's not really a direction out of the area structure plan on that question, but the town of Canmore itself, through their integrated transportation plan, doesn't want to see everybody getting in their car to come downtown over the Bow River Bridge by any stretch of the imagination. In fact, that's why our area structure plans are so prolific with bicycle connectivity, walking connectivity. There's actually a table in the appendix that talks about a lot of improvements to the pathway along the Bow River that leads to downtown. There's a number of different connection points. We've even talked about some alternative crossings should they be required. Doesn't look like that's the case from modeling, like the bridge capacity is actually there if we're not all jumping in our car by ourselves to try and get downtown. That's a road to failure. And the town has known that for years, with or without Three Sisters, that there would be some issues if we all kept going on our car dependent ways. So they're trying to do, I think, some really positive leading edge stuff with their integrated transportation plan to encourage people, if you're going to go downtown to a festival, grab your bike and head on down there. Now that type of everyday use and things like that is different than if there's emergencies. The roads are still going to be there for emergencies. The roads are still going to be there for people to take the bus and use their cars. But the idea is not to make it as convenient, right? And so what the idea in the integrated transportation plan, and I welcome anybody to read it, it's on canmore.ca, is to incentivize and make walking, biking, and transit the transit mode of choice. And so that's the direction the area structure plans are following. They're following council direction.
Okay, thank you, Chris. The next question I will read out, but actually I don't believe anyone on the panel would be able to answer it. It says, how is Canmore doing in their goal to push 40% of their transportation out of vehicles? We're 40% of the way there and traffic just keeps getting worse. I wanted to read the question, obviously, to be transparent for our members. Pauline, perhaps, oh, Sarah, are you able to answer that, or you just popped up on my screen? Sorry.
I'm not able to answer the question, but I just want to highlight that sort of feeding into this question and what Chris was just talking about, I think about this quite a bit too, as a resident, not as a biologist. I think the town has done a pretty great job of encouraging people to ride their bikes to the festivals and whatever else around town. But we need to remember that Three Sisters Mountain Village and Smith Creek, that's a heck of a bike ride. And most people are not going to do that, especially if they have small children in tow or whatever. Like, that's actually a pretty good distance to ride your bike. So it's about, you can encourage people to engage in public transit, but if the distance is sufficient and the public transit isn't working efficiently for whatever reason, schedules and whatnot, people will still drive their cars. So I don't think that we can just pretend like the integrated transportation strategy is going to solve any potential traffic congestion issues.
Well, just a further thought to that, because you know, you're right, Sarah, we can't convince everybody to do everything we want every day. Totally get that. On the canmore.ca website, I think you'll find that currently with no changes, it's still 84% single occupancy vehicle use in Canmore, right? So that's a pretty big percentage. 10% are walking, 4% are biking, 2% are on transit. So you can see where there's absolutely room to improve, as you just said. I totally agree with that. Their goal is to get the car use down to about 60% and the walking up to about 15%, the biking up to about 20% and the transit up to about 5%. And if we can create those type of modal shifts, which is what the area structure plans are following, that's a big impact. Is it all of a sudden going to swing to 80% transit use? Yeah, you're totally right. No, it's not. That's a very long-term objective. I think we'd need even more cultural change to do that. Probably the best answer, though, Ben, is it is on canmore.ca. They do track it. They do have those goals. I just read some of the high-level ones for you, but it's definitely a strategic shift. It's a number of years, and our area structure plans are supporting that shift.
Thank you very much, Chris. Just conscious that we've got about 5 minutes of time left here. I have, I think, three or four questions left in the line. So if I could close the ability for the floor to ask questions, just so that we can get through the ones that we have asked there. And thank you everyone for your engagement. The next question is for you, Chris. How many people have you heard from in your community engagement sessions, either by number or percentage of population?
I don't have that number handy, but I do know that there's almost 250 pages of that documentation within the What We Heard report. So the exact numbers, I think, would be found in that report at tsmv.ca or canmore.ca. I don't have that one handy.
Okay, thank you for that, Chris. The next question is, for how many years are the affordable housing units in the development mandated? Is there a time limit on how long the pricing must meet affordable housing standards?
Well, I'm not Canmore Community Housing, so I'm not sure I can speak authoritatively, but probably the best thing to do there would be to have a look at the Canmore Community Housing website as a template. They're not the only provider of affordable housing within the town of Canmore, and there may be more in the future, of course. But really the tenure and form of leasing and things like that, that's a decision they make that isn't actually a function of the area structure plans. So I would just direct that question back to the Canmore Community Housing website, and they'd probably be able to help you out with that.
Okay. Yeah, I think we may ask a couple of questions of the town just for clarification, that one, and maybe the request on the sustainable or transport plan and people coming downtown. Actually, on that point, next question again is for you, Chris. Will the new commercial at the four-way stop offer shopping that would potentially reduce trips downtown? I think this is referring to another area structure plan in the area.
Yeah, thank you for the question. I might, you know, invite Jessica to provide an opinion there too as well, because she probably feels lonely, you know, given all the questions coming my way. But yes, down at the four-way stop, we have within the Stewart Creek Area Structure Plan, that's existing from 2004, proposed a commercial shopping area called the Gateway at Three Sisters. And absolutely, that is one of the core aspects that was considered within the Village and Smith Creek Area Structure Plans about how to get people to not all jump in their car and drive downtown. But there's tension there too, because we need to be cognizant and careful that our intent is not to all of a sudden empty out downtown either. Like, that would be a worst thing that we could possibly do. That's not the plan. So we are not looking to provide a alternative, right? Pick me, coach. We're going to go all shopping in the Gateway at Three Sisters. We're not going to go downtown anymore. That is 100% definitely not on the page. What we're looking to do is complement downtown Canmore and provide services that may not be available in a format that may not be available within downtown Canmore. One of those examples is a grocery store. So we do have a grocer that is interested in going there. We heard a lot from Canmore residents. Interestingly, they want a gas station at the Gateway, the Three Sisters. And that's a function, of course, of some of the people going currently right now to Calgary to go shopping. Some of them go shopping at Costco. Some of them go into the Crowfoot area, all those things like that. And so the Gateway at Three Sisters, one of its aspects is to prevent what we call that leakage of people that are like, I just can't find what I need in Canmore. I'm going to get in my car and I'm going to go to Calgary and I'm going to get it. And I'm going to phone my friends and see how many other things they need that I can pick up on the way for them, type of thing as well. So we're hoping to actually be a complement to Main Street, supportive of Main Street, but also provide some of the daily needs that people need within walking and biking distance and transit distance, because Rome is going to stretch through the whole plan as well. And encourage them to use the Gateway at Three Sisters for the needs appropriate to that. And Jessica, I think you've had a few clients that have asked you about commercial services and Three Sisters in the past. Do you have something to add there?
Sure. I don't think that any additional commercial we add up in Three Sisters is going to impact people's use of downtown. Downtown's the heart and soul and character of Canmore, and people will always want to go downtown. So I don't think we're replacing that in any way. What it does do is provide some really essential services for the community and the growing community up in Three Sisters. Practically, though, people can bike and e-bike downtown to, you know, if you do have a family of four, getting groceries from an e-bike is not practical. So that means people are taking cars downtown and the traffic is getting insane in the summer. So having the ability for people to do grocery shopping up in Three Sisters when they live up in Three Sisters will be really beneficial on a lot of fronts for the residents, for the traffic downtown. And, sometimes those groceries, especially during COVID times, those grocery stores get pretty full. There is a need for more. Not just grocery stores, but just some of the essential services that the residents have been waiting for a long time, and they'll be really happy to see.
Thank you very much, Jessica. I'm just conscious here of the time. So what I would like to do, I think it's been great. It's been a really good debate. I thank everyone for all the questions we've had in there. But I would like to give each panelist a couple of minutes for some closing remarks. And then we can let people get on with their days. So perhaps from a closing remarks perspective, Sarah, if I could ask to start with you, if that's okay. And then Chris to yourself, then Rod, and then Jessica. And then I'll close the meeting down, if that's okay with everyone. Sarah, over to you. Thank you.
Thanks, Ben. And thanks, everybody. I think this has been a really rich discussion. And thank you very much for all of your participation. I didn't actually prepare any closing kind of statements. So I guess all I really want to say is that we are at a point in our community where we really need to decide where we will prioritize wildlife needs ahead of or ahead, or where we're going to prioritize them on the spectrum of our community needs. And so if we want to be a community that truly coexists with wildlife and is the leader that we currently are for how human wildlife coexistence can be, then these ASPs are not the way to get there. These ASPs will actually take us backwards in terms of all the work that we've done to coexist with wildlife. And so I'm not saying that this has to be zero development, although obviously that would be my preference. I understand we're committed to develop these lands, but the current ASPs, the way that they're proposed, are not the best way to do that.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Chris, over to you.
Like Sarah, I didn't prepare any closing remarks either. So sort of off the cuff, thanks for the example, Sarah.
Sorry, I caught you all off guard.
It just gives Jessica and Rod more time. So that's all good. No problem. I just wanted to say I share Sarah's thoughts that I thought today's discussion was really robust and engaging. I appreciated hearing the questions and the thoughts from everybody. I've heard lots of thoughts, of course, over the course of 5 years. But having these kind of interaction sessions, especially during a pandemic, is always beneficial. So super appreciate that. If there was something I think I'd say in closing, I'd say it's important for the residents of Canmore that are making public submissions next week to focus their energy on aspects that are within the realm of possibility for council. Sometimes some of the things that councils are asked to do, we want you to do X, we want you to do Y, why aren't you doing this, why aren't you doing that? There's not a lot they can do in some cases. And so it's important to actually make sure that what you're suggesting, and I would absolutely welcome suggestions. Councils find it very helpful to say, what would you propose? What are the suggestions you have? How would you make a change if there's an aspect that you're not particularly happy about? That is far more engaging and powerful for a council to be assisted by than standing up at a public hearing and saying, I just don't like this plan, and I don't like this plan, and did I say I don't like the plan? Because sometimes there's not a lot they can do with it. And the whole point behind a public hearing with a council is to give them feedback. So absolutely, you can give them feedback and say, I don't like the plan. But you should also have feedback prepared that says, I might like the plan better if you did X. Or, you know, it might not be possible. I understand that too. But I'm just trying to, I think, give some advice of how you could really help town council effectively gather community input and make a difference in terms of their input. And I think that would be really important. I believe our area structure plans are very strong. They're fully rooted in council direction and a municipal development plan and the integrated transportation plan. And I look forward to the public hearings and ultimately a decision to council in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chris. Rod, over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Ben. I did get an extra 2 minutes there. Thank you, Chris, for now I can put my, I've got some closing remarks. So, I think this is great debate. I thank everybody for showing up. Thank you for inviting me. I feel this is a huge, huge 30-year development proposal, arguably potentially doubling our community. And I just really would encourage council to look after the community. And I know TSMV, you have a right to develop, but I really feel at this point the town has to look after itself and make sure that if development occurs, it's the right development in so much as the benefit to the community. So, 30 years, Chris and I are going to be long gone. We're going to be in the seniors home together playing bridge. And really, it's my son who's in grade 12 right now and is going to be close to my age by the time this development gets done. So, I really implore council and everybody, TSMV included, the community itself, to get involved and make sure that this development fits for Canmore. And that's it. Thank you very much, Ben.
You must be way older than me, man. I plan on living forever, too.
You haven't changed in the years that I've known you.
See?
Also hard to get rid of the image of you guys playing bridge in the seniors' home together now. That's very sweet. I like that one. And finally, Jessica, over to you. I think you're still on mute, Jessica.
Sorry.
There we go.
As I had said before, it is impossible to please everyone. We're never going to come to 100% consensus in regards to the right way to move forward. Chris was definitely in the hot seat for a lot of these, a lot of this conversation today. And, you know, it really seemed that these questions that came up, Chris had heard them before. He had the answers. This is not a fly by the seat of my pants kind of thing. These, you know, it seems the developers have really put a lot of time and thought and effort into this. And he answered the questions with really solid answers because this has been thought out. I think that, you know, this has probably had more discussions and thoughts and, you know, planning than any other development that I'm aware of anyway. We need housing in town. We need, you know, housing and affordable housing. And that's just a reality that we need to address. We need more commercial. We need more tourism and visitor offerings that will attract people to Canmore, not just the existing people who already know about Canmore, but to attract people to come here because tourism is going to be the long-term economic drive of Canmore. And we are lacking in, you know, offerings to provide. And I think there's a lot of opportunity here where we can create that. And we're going to be attracting people, not just for day trips, but for longer term stays. This is going to be really important to all of the economy in Canmore in the future. There are concerns that people have. I think these still can be addressed. These can still be worked on. We can still move forward while, you know, making sure that a lot of these concerns are addressed. I think the positives at this point outweigh, you know, a lot of these things that can still be worked on. I think that, you know, it's time for town council to move forward and approve these developments.
Okay, thank you very much indeed, Jessica. And thank you to all of our panelists. We'll be providing you with a $50 gift certificate to Edible Life. Normally with Conversation Cafe, they provide the food. And, you know, we certainly look forward to the day when we can do this again in person. But, you know, the engagement has been fantastic. Our mission here at the Chamber of Commerce is to sustain a successful business community in the Bow Valley by elevating, connecting and advocating for our members. I certainly feel that we've connected today and I hope we've gone some way to address the other two as well. I do apologize that we've run over time here, but you know, what a great way to start the day. Thank you everyone for your time and your engagement. Hope you all have a wonderful rest of the day. Thank you.
Thanks everyone, take care.
Great job, Ben. It's Michelle, I'm leaving.
Okay, thanks, Michelle, no problem.
Yeah, thank you, Ben, that was excellent. Yeah. I'm gonna sign off too.
Okay, thanks, Natalie.
Have a great day.
Yeah, you too, I'll sign off now too.